Hi there, and welcome to Kit Good. I'm Bruce, and today we're going to be doing a continuation of the photography video. I do apologise for my voice. I am unfortunately sick at the moment, but I wanted to get this video out. If you've not seen the original photography video, I'll pop a link in the top right of this YouTube video so you can follow it. But this is all about the things that we couldn't include in that first video, which I'd group into colour temperature, post-processing, and focus stacking. For the first two, I'm going to be using free software that I've tried and I'm reasonably happy with. For the final one, I've yet to find a free solution that works really well for focus stacking, so I'm going to show you in Photoshop and I'm going to list some software that you may want to look at in terms of investigating focus stacking in future. I appreciate that some of you may not have raw photos to play with, so what I've done is I've included a download link to an example raw file, which is a photograph of the Halgrim that you can see on screen now. But now, let's dive into it. So a key difference in this video and the last video is that by its nature, I have to give more opinions here. When I'm developing photographs, I'm going for essentially a look which is as close to in-hand as possible. And that may not be for everyone. That's absolutely fine. The stuff I'm going to tell you in this is largely based on my opinion, and it's going to be less objective than what I could do in the last video when I was explaining things like aperture and ISO and things like that. So just bear that in mind before we really dive into it. There is by nature going to be some of my opinion here, and it's absolutely fine if you disagree with that. So all light is not created equal, and in fact, light has a temperature. You'll typically see this represented in something called Kelvin, or K. Looking at this picture here, you can see that on the left-hand side, the cool light, that's around about 10,000 Kelvin. Then all the way to the right, warm light is around about 2,000 Kelvin. Now, neutral light, by which I mean that white within this light appears white and not slightly blue or slightly orange, reddish, that neutrality area is around about 5,000 to 6,000 Kelvin, which is typically represented as daylight. Now, when I'm painting, I paint under a 5,000 Kelvin daylight lamp. And so when I'm taking photos, I'm trying to ensure that my photograph matches my painting light. Therefore, I'm trying to aim for around about that neutral 5,000 Kelvin area. This is really critical for when you're taking photographs if you have lights that are different from your painting lamp in terms of how you light your photograph, and it's to ensure that the colour temperature matches across the board. The final thing I'd say here is that there is no objective real colour temperature. Different models will look differently under different temperature lights, and neither one is the correct one. It's all just a reference to the light that they're under. However, most painting competitions, most displays are going to offer neutral light, and therefore, if you paint under a neutral light, you want to ensure that everything matches in terms of your vision. So let's move to the software now, and I'm using software called RAW Therapy. I will include a link to this so you can download it and install it. And obviously, if you've not already done so, you can download the RAW file that I'm using. So to get started, you want to navigate to where you saved your RAW file in this left-hand menu, and right-click on the image here and put it in the queue. And then using this left-hand menu, you can navigate to the queue. And here's where we'll begin to edit it. Just need to right-click on it and select Open in Editor, and it will move you to the editing view. And then this is that editing view. When you're editing photos, this will be where you spend most of your time when you're in RAW Therapy. You can see here in the top left of the image, it gives you all the information on the camera that took the photo, including things like the aperture, shutter speed, etc. All very useful. You can also toggle different background colors using these buttons along the top, where you can navigate between them, and you can also toggle just certain color channels if you want to isolate any of them. You'll also see that in the top left there are a number of image scopes which let you look at the colors within the image more accurately. However, this would be a video on its own just to learn how to navigate through and understand these. We're going to start by selecting the color submenu from the right-hand menu. On this menu, we can access the white balance submenu, which lets us mess with the temperature of our image. Now, with all of these dials, you can use the free flow color temperature dial, or you can use the actual toggles themselves. What I'd say is don't adjust things too quickly. You can see as we go to the left, the image gets a lot cooler, and as we go all the way to the right,
the image gets an awful lot warmer and that orange and reddish glow begins to come into the image. Because I know, though, that the background that I use to take this image is neutral, I can use the color pick tool to select the background and it will automatically adjust the color temperature to match a neutral. This is, in my view, the easiest way of doing any sort of white balance or anything like that. I'm not a big fan of making big broad scale changes. I want the photo environment to be as close to how I want it to look in the edited environment with minimal post-processing. So just bear that in mind. One of the things that you can buy if you're so inclined is these white balance cards. You can basically place them in the in your studio when you're taking your photographs, and then you'll be able to use those as good solid neutral references for white balancing. So you put them in, you take your first photo, then you put your miniature in and take subsequent photos, and then you just copy those white balance settings over into the subsequent picture because you know you've used a very neutral color to get your color balance. It's just a neat, cheap way of doing white balance automatically. One of the things I'd encourage you to do as you do your editing is to use the before and after view. This is busted in the top left. And with it on the right-hand side, you can see the color balance that we've changed. And on the left-hand side is the original image. This for me is critical in ensuring that I've not strayed too far away from the original image in any way, shape or form. So once I've set the color balance, one of the next things I like to do is crop the image. So I click on the transform tab, which is in the right-hand column. And you'll see that the crop submenu is selected. Now, I'm typically uploading photos to Instagram, so I like to do a 1-1 ratio. And you can see that there's basically a selection tool which lets you crop the image as you desire it. Your preferred method of cropping will be entirely dependent on your end point and what you're uploading to, and also some artistic considerations. But the main thing that you need to know is that the area outside of the crop frame is not lost. It's just removed from the output that's processed by RAW Therapy. So you can crop away knowing that you can reset the crop frame at any time. So with the crop set, we can now move to the exposure tab, which is again in that right-hand column. Now, what I will say, and I guess this is something I keep repeating in all of this post-processing talk, is that you shouldn't be adjusting any of the dials here too much. If you are, you should go back and retake the photo. If you're doing minor adjustments, I think personally that's fine. If you're doing big scale exposure compensations or anything like that, it probably means that you've done a few steps out of line and it's better to go back to the original photography setup and retake the photo there to ensure that it's good there. You don't want to be fixing things in RAW Therapy. You want to be improving slightly upon them to get them more how they are in hand. So on this menu, we can use the exposure compensation button to alter the exposure. And you can see you can go from very bright to very dark very quickly. So if you're going to play with this, make sure that you only adjust it ever so slightly. You want to make sure that the exposure matches how the model looks in hand. From here, you can also play with other settings. Now, these aren't necessarily settings that I play with, but they are there if you need them. You can adjust the black levels within the image, essentially make dark areas appear much more dark. Equally, you can do the same for light areas. Take anything which has a higher value and make it even higher or slightly lower. Now, the contrast setting is maybe one of the sliders that you do want to adjust. Because of how the human eye works, contrast can be one of those things that's hard to pick up on photographs to make sure it matches the human eye. But you can see as I play with this setting, the contrast, the difference between the light and dark areas, either decreases or increases. Now again, it is not a setting that I would adjust wholesale. I would maybe adjust it very subtly to match how it looks in hand. Finally, with saturation, we can adjust how vibrant the colors are. All the way on the right, and the colors are almost radioactive. All the way on the left, and we have a non-saturated black and white image. Saturation, again, like other things, it can be subtly adjusted. You may find that because of how lenses work, that your image needs to be adjusted for saturation ever so slightly, but don't play with it too much. Now, generally, that's all I will adjust. I will just mention lastly here, there is the vignette filter, which you can use to apply either a dark or light halo around your image. This is more of a creative thing. You may find it draws more attention to the central point of the image and the miniature. It's not something I personally play with, but it is there if you want it. There is also a detail subtab, which lets you do some more fine tuning on the image. And the first of these is called sharpening, which is basically how crispy, I guess is the easiest way of framing it, the image is. Now, this is done using an unsharp mask. It is subtle at the best of times, I would say, and you're going to have a hard time working out what it's doing unless you zoom in very closely to the image to see exactly what it's doing. But basically, as you increase the sharpening amount, the image will look crispier. And you can see here as I zoom in to the image, that as I increase that, it looks it essentially looks more grainy, more granular. And as I shift it to the left, it looks softer. Would I play with this? I personally don't. Depending on the lens you use, you may wish to experiment with sharpening to see if you can get it quite close to how things look in hand. But again, it's not one that I particularly play with. Finally, I want to mention the spot removal tool. Again, this is something, I mean, even this example, I'm a little bit hesitant to show. But if you had some dust flecks in your model, something that shouldn't be in the photo, that is an error, not a painting error, but like a dust error, you could use the spot removal tool to remove it. Basically, it takes a sample and patches it up to hide something like that. Again, this is kind of an ethical point. That should be used, I mean, really never, unless it was something that you couldn't retake the photo without it being dusted or anything like that. So I wanted to mention it because it is a feature that some people may use, but obviously because of its ability to remove things that are there, it should be used sparingly. Now, once you've made your edits, you obviously want to know how to export them. So you're going to head back over to the cue part. You can see there's an output location that you can adjust here and a file format. I always use PNG. I think that's the best output. And then you toggle the cue button and it processes the cue and exports your image with the required settings. And you can see here in the output follow, here is the edited image. Again, subtle changes based on what was fed into it, but that's how I prefer to do post-processing. This is maybe more obvious in this before after view. As I zoom in, you can see the changes aren't subtle, if anything. I'm really just aiming to get it closer to how I feel it looks in hands under certain lighting conditions. And really, in terms of my photography, my endpoints, that's what I'm looking to achieve. The final thing I want to touch on in this video is focus stacking, which is a way of taking a sequence of images with different focal points and then stacking them together so that everything, every part of the miniature is in focus. To do this, all you need is a sequence of images taken at different photo lengths. So I set up my tripod, I manually focus into one part, and then I take a picture, and then I take another picture, etc., and do this. You can see here that in this folder, I've got 11 pictures of the same image, all at different focal points, and I'm going to use Photoshop to stack them together. So to do this in Photoshop, you go to File, Scripts, and Load Files into Stack. You'll then be asked to browse to select the images that you want to load into the stack. So here's the 11 images that I mentioned. It will then process them, and you want to make sure that you've right-clicked this automatically attempt to align images. And what it will then do is think for a good while, because it'll look at each of the images and understand how they need to be stacked in line with each other so that all the lights essentially match. Once that's done, you'll see that all of them sit in the layers panel in the bottom right. Then you're going to go to Edit and Auto Blend Layers. Make sure that the Auto Blend method is set to Stack Images and hit OK. And it will then again think for a long while and blend all of the layers into a single focus stacked image. And here's what that looks like. You can see each layer in the stack has a little bit of the area masked out, so that all of the stuff is beautifully in focus. And as I zoom into this, it's not just that one area has focus, all parts of the image are in focus, which is really handy with certain miniatures, certainly miniatures with a lot of depth where you need to ensure that everything is in focus. You can then export this out as an image, save it, upload it, etc. It's a little tool that can be really handy in certain circumstances. And that is it. I appreciate that's an awful lot of ground to cover. We do like to keep these videos relatively condensed so you can get a lot of information in a short period of time without too much time investment. Obviously that covers a lot of things, but it is a good companion piece to the first. So if you're taking pictures of your miniatures, if you're improving things, hopefully this has been useful. That's all for now though. As always, if you like this content, please give us a like, a subscribe, consider checking out the Patreon if you want to support us or join the community. But for now, that's it. Goodbye, and I'll see you in the next one.